that wherever you find a Vietnamese today, you kill them, I will make him sound like a butcher. But naturally, to boost up the morale, Almighty God will not say that, okay, run away. To boost up the morale, he has to say that don't get scared, fight. And it's a fight between truth and falsehood. And such examples you find in the Bible. If you see in the Gospel of Matthew, you will find in the Hindu scriptures, in Bhagavad Gita, full Bhagavad Gita speaks about that. That Lord Krishna, he is giving advice to Arjun in the battlefield. He says in Bhagavad Gita chapter number 1, verse number 46, 47, 48, in the battlefield, he puts his weapons and says, I would prefer being killed unarmed than to fight my relatives. So Shri Krishna says, just a few verses later, in Bhagavad Gita chapter number 2, verse number 2 and 3, that how, oh Arjun, how can you be so impotent? It is the duty of the Kshatriya, it is the duty of the warrior to fight. And only if you fight, will you go to the heavenly planet, to the paradise. And it goes on, you can see my cassette on terrorism and jihad, that I've spoken in detail. But when the Quran speaks about this, non-Muslims have a problem. Imagine if I say that Bhagavad Gita is saying, kill your relatives, it will be delvish. And Bhagavad Gita does say that. If I say Bhagavad Gita says, kill your relatives, it will be devilish. In context, it says that when you have to fight against untruth, if you have to fight against oppression, stand for truth, even if it be against your relatives. And as far as this message of Bhagavad Gita is concerned, we are for it. Quran says the same. Therefore, to make the non-Muslims understand Islam, according to me, the master key given in the Quran by our Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 64, which says, Ta'ala ila kalmatin sawa in bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. The best way to make the non-Muslim understand Islam and Quran is Ta'ala ila kalmatin sawa in bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illallah. That we worship none but one Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Arun Shuri, after quoting verse number 5 of Surah Tawbah, he jumps to verse number 7. You know why? Verse number 6 has the answer to sickness. Verse number 6 of Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9 says, that if any of the pagans, if any of the disbelievers, if any of your enemies seek asylum, if they want peace, grant it to them. So that they may hear the word of Almighty God and escort them to a place of security. Because these are men who do not understand. The Quran does not say let them go. Today, if the enemy wants peace, maximum the army general will say, okay, let them go. Quran does not say that. Quran says, escort them to a place of security. Because these are men who do not understand. Just a few months back, when I was giving a similar example, there was a non-Muslim from the audience who said, Brother Zakir, even you are quoting out of context. You haven't quoted the full verse of Surah Tawbah chapter 9 verse number 5. And he went also to say that the full verse reads, after saying that in the battlefield wherever you find the kafir, kill them and slay them, wait for them in every stratagem of war. It continues and says, but if they repent and if they establish prayers, regular prayers, and regular charity, then let them go. For Allah is forgiving and merciful. So he's telling, we come to know that only if they accept Islam, do we have to leave them. See, many a time it becomes difficult for us to give the full explanation, otherwise the lecture will be maybe 10 hours long. Average people say that I'm a marathon speaker. But I thank that Hindu brother and said, Jazakallah for giving me an opportunity for clarifying more. Verse number 5 of Surah Tawbah does refer that if the unbeliever, if he repents and establish regular prayer and give regular charity, indicating he becomes a Muslim, then let him go. But verse number 6, what does it say? If he becomes a Muslim, let him go. But verse number 6 says that if the unbeliever seeks asylum, wants peace, don't just let him go. Escort him to a place of security. If he becomes a Muslim, let him go. But if he does not become a Muslim and wants peace, don't just leave him. Escort him to a place of security, because maybe now he's in between, he's on the fence. Those who accept Islam find they're Muslims. He wants peace. Maybe the non-Muslims, they may kill him. Maybe the non-Muslim would like to take revenge. Why is he wanting for peace? So Almighty God says in the Quran, don't leave them. Escort them to a place of security. So that's the reason critics like Arun Shuri, they skip verses, they quote out of context, and you can give hundreds of such examples. If you go on the internet, it's very common, and we find now many of the non-Muslims, they go on the internet, and to speak again in the Quran has become easy, therefore more books have been published. Very easy. You know, internet is a boon and a bane. Initially when it started, there were more websites against Islam than for Islam. Now Muslims have caught up. There are good sites also. But you don't have to be a scholar to find mistakes in the Quran, alleged mistakes in the Quran. And it's difficult to reply. The moment you keep on replying, more and more keep on coming. That's the reason we have open question answer sessions. So strategy number 2 is, they quote the verses of the Quran and the Islamic scripture out of context. Third strategy is, they say things about Islam which are alien to Islam. It does not exist in Islam. For example, many critics say that Islam is an unscientific religion. Just to give you one example, time will not permit me to give several examples. Since nowadays we are having a controversy on the famous Bangladeshi writer Taslima Nasreen, she says that the Quran mentions that the sun revolves around the earth, and if we have to believe in such an outdated book, how can the Muslims advance? And I challenge anyone to point out any verse of the Quran which says that the sun revolves around the earth. And I said this several years back when I had a debate about her in the Bombay Union of Journalists. What she's referring to is the verse of the Quran which I quoted earlier in my talk in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, which says, "Huwa allazi khalaqal layla wan nahara." It is Allah who has created the night and the day. "Wa shamsa wal qamar," the sun and the moon. "Kullun fi falaki yasbahun," each one traveling in its own orbit. Each one traveling in its own orbit. So here the Quran says that the sun is revolving in motion. Nowhere does the Quran say that the sun is revolving on the earth. It's her own understanding, her own interpretation. The word earth is not there in the verse of the Quran. The Quran says it revolves in a motion which I explained earlier. The Quran says besides revolving, it also rotates. When I was in school, I didn't know about that. And now science justified that. So many times, the critics of Islam, they say things about Islam which are alien to Islam. And very often, fourth strategy used.